In the eyes of the Spanish police, their two cars met up, and then Savage drove off in the white Renault, leaving the red Ford and the other two terrorists behind in Spain. Just before 1 p.m, Savage drove into the border checkpoint, and the Spanish police allowed him to pass through. On the Gibraltar side, British security officials took over the surveillance, and they too allowed Savage's car to drive through unhindered. Just why British security men did not stop a car that only 2 hours later came under suspicion as a dangerous car bomb is one of the key questions in the Gibraltar affair. And the biggest question as the car crossed the airfield towards the town of Gibraltar is how much was known about what the white Renault actually contained. According to the Spanish security police, they thought it was possible that the car contained a bomb, but they were also working on the theory that the explosives had already been delivered to Gibraltar by sea and that the car was now going to pick them up. British officials have made no public comment on what they believed, but there is little doubt that the car could have been intercepted before it reached the town centre. Instead, Savage drove on, apparently unaware that nearby British troops, including SAS men, were lying in wait. Under surveillance, he drove into the street where the Tuesday parade ends and parked his car beside the ancient city wall. Back at the border at around 2:30 that afternoon, the other two members of the IRA team crossed into Gibraltar on foot. And again, they were allowed to enter unimpeded. In a street near the parked car, they met up with Savage. And then at around 3:30, they all left the area on foot, leaving the parked white Renault behind them unattended. Sir Geoffrey Howe gave this account in the House of Commons.
Their presence and actions near the parked Renault car gave rise to strong suspicion that it contained a bomb, which appeared to be corroborated by a rapid technical examination of the car.
In fact, the car was later found to contain no explosive device, and according to an expert, a rapid examination should have shown that there was no significant bomb in it. George Stiles ran bomb disposal operations in Northern Ireland during his tour of duty there.
Well, I'm sure that the army bomb disposal man was somewhere near and observing the scene, and when the white car came in, he would be told that that's the terrorist bringing in the car, and I'm sure he would have quickly seen that it carried no significant weight of explosive.
How would he have seen that?
Well, the posture of the car on its springs is dictated by the weight it's carrying, and if you put 100 weight of cement in the boot of a car, which is about car bomb size, it shows. Agreed, there could have been a smaller bomb inside it, and I expect the bomb disposal man anticipated such. He would have probably said, this hasn't got a significant bomb in it, but I'm going to treat it with care.
A photograph of the real car taken that day appears to support that view. It shows it riding high on its springs with no load over the wheel arch. At around 3:30, the terrorists began to walk back towards the border. It's now believed that the next phase in their plan would have been to bring in the real car bomb. They would then have put it in their parking space in time for the parade on Tuesday. They left the old town and were more than a mile from the parked car when Farrell and McCann, 100 yards in front of Savage, reached a petrol station, which was closed on Sunday. Then suddenly a burst of shots rang out, and in less than a minute, all three terrorists were dead, shot by the SAS. In the House of Commons, Sir Geoffrey Howe gave this account of what happened.
On their way towards the border, they were challenged by the security forces. When challenged, they made movements which led the military personnel, operating in support of the Gibraltar police, to conclude that their own lives and the lives of others were under threat. In the light of this response, they were shot. Those killed were subsequently found not to have been carrying arms.
Since that statement to the House of Commons, this week has spoken to large numbers of residents in all the blocks of flats overlooking the area where the terrorists died. We have found no one who heard a challenge being made. We have interviewed four key witnesses to the shootings. Their accounts raise serious questions about what really happened that afternoon, for they say that the British soldiers opened fire without warning, and none of them saw the IRA bombers make any threatening movements. The first witness is a housewife, Josie Silesia, whose flat is on the second floor opposite the petrol station.
Well, I saw these two couple, and I was staring at the man, because he had spiky, blonde, short hair, you know. Then all of a sudden I took my sight off them and looked up at the adventure playground. Suddenly I heard two shots. There were about two shots. So I was just looking from where that came from. And all of a sudden I saw the woman and, you know, the couple on the floor.
What Josie saw in the first seconds were the terrorists, but little of the SAS men who shot them. But our second witness had a different view, with what seems to have been a more complete picture of the shooting. The first thing she says she witnessed was a Gibraltar police car arrive from the direction of the border and suddenly screech to a halt on the other side of the road from the two IRA bombers. Seen at her window, the witness is Carmen Proetta.
I looked out of the window and all of a sudden I saw a car, police car. It stops. All of a sudden the doors were open, all of them, the four of them, and three men came out dressed in jeans and jackets, jumped over the intersection barrier in the road, guns in hand.
Carmen Proetta has given us a sworn affidavit detailing what she saw. She says she is willing to testify at the inquest, though she has not yet been approached by the police. In a statement that will cause great controversy, she says that the first two terrorists had their hands in the air at the moment they were shot by the SAS. She also says that the British soldiers fired the first shot without warning as they jumped over the central barrier in the middle of the road.
They didn't do anything. They just jumped with the guns in their hands and they just went and shot these people, that's all. They didn't say anything, they didn't scream, they didn't shout, they didn't do anything. These people were turning their heads back to see what was happening, and when they saw these men had the guns in their hand, they just put their hands up. It looked like the man was protecting the girl because he stood in front of her, but there was no chance. I mean, they went to the floor immediately, they dropped.
At the same moment, Stephen Bullock, a British lawyer, was walking with his wife and baby son. He heard shots and looked towards the petrol station.
Outside the petrol station, I saw a man who I'm fairly sure was wearing a bright yellow short-sleeved shirt, standing with both hands outstretched, holding a gun like this, and firing very rapidly into another man with blonde hair, wearing a white shirt, who was falling backwards with his hands like this, and falling back almost in slow motion. He went right down and the firing continued. He was still being shot at as he went down.
And the moment these shots were being fired into him, how close were the two men together?
About as far as I am from you. Say 4 feet.
Really close range?
Oh, yes. Yes, undoubtedly. I mean, close enough. Let's put it this way. I think with one step, he could have actually touched the person he was shooting.
Looking from her window, Josie Silesia saw the terrorists on the ground and an SAS man still pointing his pistol at them.
As you saw the two lying on the ground and another man standing above them, what happened?
I heard shots, about four or five shots.
More shots?
See?
What were they like?
Continuously.
Like an automatic fire, no? Automatic. Like that, blah, 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 blah.
See? Like that. One after the other.
Carmen Proetta also saw a gunman fire at the two people who were lying on the ground.
Yes, he bent down and with the two hands he got his gun like that and went on shooting at them.
How many times do you think he shot?
Two times at least.
Mairéad Farrell and Daniel McCann were the two terrorists who died by the petrol station. According to our information, which has not been officially confirmed, Farrell was shot twice in the face and once under the left breast in the area of the heart. McCann, the most dangerous terrorist, was shot 8 or 9 times, several times in the chest, and once below the chin, the bullet exiting through the top of his head. Sean Savage, the third terrorist, was not killed in the first burst of shots, as he was about 100 yards behind the others. For some reason, perhaps because he saw or heard the shooting, he ran back towards the old town, pursued by at least one SAS man. Savage died round a corner beside a large oak tree. According to our fourth witness, she was near the tree when a man later identified as Savage ran past her. He was pursued by a second man who had a gun in his left hand.
He just lifted his left arm and I heard the first shot. It was then when I looked back and saw the other man that was running fall back as the other man continued shooting at him.
Did you hear any warning of any kind given by the man with the gun?
No.
Did you hear him say, stop?
No.
Police?
No, just happened so sudden.
He just opened fire, just like that?
Yeah.
Our witness says she was only a few feet from the soldier when he opened fire. Later, Savage was found lying face upwards beside the tree. The witness insists that he was shot in the back, with more shots fired as he lay on the ground.
I looked back and I saw the other man that was running just being shot and just fall back.
Fall backwards?
And he was bouncing on the floor when the other man continued shooting at him about three or four shots more, and I thought he was dead.
You mean you saw the man who was shot in the back?
Yes, through the back.
At this point, the female witness ran away.